Alien is one of the most influential sci-fi films ever made. Playing with the formula of slasher movies where the main characters are picked off one by one, it spawned a whole new subgenre of science fiction survival horror. It's also famed for its brilliantly effective visual design, taking place on a grungy industrial spaceship that's invaded by a viscerally terrifying alien monster. Artist H.R. Giger designed the alien itself, a vicious predator whose body combined elements of skeletons, machines, and genital imagery. Giger's work is often described as biomechanical, but we're not talking about that today.
Okay, you're dressed, huh?
Are you?
Can I finish my coffee?
In this video, we're covering the costumes of that first Alien movie, an aspect of its thoughtful design that usually flies under the radar. Hi there, I'm Gavia Baker-Whitelaw and this is Behind the Scenes, decoding the world of costume design. To understand why Alien looks so good, you need to know about the ecosystem surrounding its creation. Released in 1979, Alien was Ridley Scott's second feature film. He signed on to direct a screenplay by Dan O'Bannon, who previously wrote the sci-fi movie Dark Star in 1974 and worked as a special effects supervisor on Star Wars. Alongside Alien concept artists Ron Cobb, Chris Foss, and H.R. Giger, Dan O'Bannon also worked on Alejandro Jodorowsky's Dune. Famously, this version of Dune was never actually completed or released, but Jodorowsky brought together an impressive creative team to bring the film to life, and their storyboards and concept art had a huge impact on later movies like Star Wars and Alien. So, by the time Ridley Scott signed on to direct Alien, all of these men had already spent years working on wildly imaginative sci-fi art that never saw the light of day. Ron Cobb and costume designer John Mollo had also worked on the first Star Wars film, which was a key inspiration for Ridley Scott to join this project in the first place. It was a revolutionary time for sci-fi cinema. To give you an idea of where we were when Alien came out, the futuristic worlds of Star Trek and 2001: A Space Odyssey had both been around for over a decade, overlapping with the moon landing in 1969. Star Wars and Close Encounters of the Third Kind both arrived in 1977, with Mad Max in 79 and Blade Runner in 82, Hollywood was about to embrace a craze for gritty, dystopian futures. Meanwhile, the 1970s saw an influx of slasher movies like The Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Alien was perfectly timed to bring all these factors together.
Mind if I give it a shot?
Please do.
A mature sci-fi thriller that combined gruesome horror with a tightly paced script, embracing a dystopian tone while paying close attention to visual detail. 40 years on, it's aged incredibly well.
Just a minute. I mean, let's not be too hasty. We don't know anything about it.
Our main characters are the crew of the Nostromo, a freighter ship owned by the Weyland-Yutani Corporation. Often described as truckers in space, these characters are blue-collar workers. Their job is similar to working on a cargo ship or oil tanker, and the ship itself looks extraordinarily real and worn. Dressed in rugged, practical uniforms, these characters are mostly average-looking and middle-aged, which adds to the authentic atmosphere. Unlike most sci-fi movies of the time, Alien makes no attempt to predict how people will dress in the future. Elsewhere in this universe, maybe other people are wearing bold futuristic outfits like in Star Trek, but the crew of the Nostromo aren't fashionable. They dress in dull, long-lasting clothes supplied by their employer. While the later films expand on the political subtext of the original, we already see hints of Weyland-Yutani's corporate power on the Nostromo. Along with the pervasive branding of the company's logo, there's an implication that these characters are locked into an unfair contract. They're overtly working class, a group of people doing a difficult, lonely job for relatively low pay.
Before we dock, I think we ought to discuss the bonus situation.
Right.
Brett and
right.
I, we think we ought to, we deserve full shares, right,
right,
baby?
You see, Mr. Park and I feel that the bonus situation has never been on an equitable level.
Well, you get what you contracted for like everybody else.
This is still very unusual for a spacefaring sci-fi movie, a genre that usually focuses on high-achieving astronauts, explorers, military commanders, and scientists. Despite being stamped with corporate logos, each crew member finds some way to express their own tastes. Their personalities shine through in how they choose to customize their uniforms. At one end of the scale, we have Captain Dallas, who is one of the neatest crew members, wearing a clean but well-worn Nostromo uniform jacket. Then at the other end, we have Brett, a lower-level engineering technician. Actor Harry Dean Stanton often played working-class characters and people who have lived difficult lives. In Alien, he's at the bottom of the pecking order, possibly the oldest crew member, but still stuck in an unpleasant, dirty job in the guts of the ship. He doesn't care much about Weyland-Yutani, something we can clearly infer from his costume, which includes a disheveled jacket, an old baseball cap, and a Hawaiian shirt. His supervisor is Parker, the chief engineer, who also looks pretty relaxed, but isn't openly flouting the rules. Meanwhile, Ash, the science officer, is eerily clean and sterile, wearing a short-sleeved shirt that puts you in mind of surgical scrubs. Ripley, in her plain jumpsuit and sneakers, is a neutral yet relatable figure. In a horror story about people panicking and reacting stupidly to an encroaching disaster, she is the voice of reason. She's the one who attempts to follow safety protocols that might have saved her crewmates.
Wait a minute. If we let it in, the ship could be infected. You know the quarantine procedure.
24 hours for decontamination.
You could die in 24 hours. Open the hatch.
Listen to me. If we break quarantine, we could all die.
Look, could you open the goddamn hatch? We have to get him inside.
It makes sense for Ripley to have a pretty neat and tidy appearance, following the guidelines set out for her job. At the same time, she's not a goody-two-shoes who follows the rules for no reason. She has excellent common sense and survival skills. And once she realizes that the Weyland-Yutani rulebook is useless to her situation, she discards it alongside her uniform. She ends the film by stripping out of her jumpsuit, surviving thanks to her own ingenuity. Alien went on to inspire a franchise of sequels, prequels, and spin-offs. Its universe has evolved a great deal since 1979. But that success is still rooted in the evocative atmosphere of the original movie. And from a design perspective, I think that first film is still the best. It combines a realistic tone with symbolic visual choices woven seamlessly into the story. For instance, the film literally begins with the crew of the Nostromo looking like newborn babies emerging from their pods, setting the scene for more disturbing reproductive imagery when the alien arrives. And when Ripley strips down and steps into her clean white spacesuit at the end, it's like she's being reborn again. This film also had an obvious impact on a whole host of other movies, including John Carpenter's The Thing and the more direct references like Event Horizon and Pitch Black. It popularized a very recognizable style of industrial spaceships staffed by jumpsuit-wearing crews, a recurring theme in numerous sci-fi movies and video games. These days, that's a cliché unto itself, to the point where Ridley Scott's recent Alien prequels look very derivative alongside all the other films sharing a similar aesthetic.
You think we wasted our time coming here, don't you?
That's both a mark of the original film's success and a sign that Hollywood needs to give more creative leeway to the current generation of concept artists who could easily be the next H.R. Giger or John Mollo. In the 21st century, which new films will inspire a similarly influential image of the future?
I should reach the frontier in about 6 weeks. With a little luck, the network will pick me up.
If you enjoyed this video, you might also like my episode about Pacific Rim, a visual masterpiece that outshines most contemporary blockbusters. And if you're new to the channel and enjoy these videos, be sure to hit the like button and subscribe so you'll never miss a future episode of Behind the Scenes. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.